Welcome to Theater of the Mind Entertainment, a Call of Cthulhu tabletop RPG playthrough radio drama, featuring our victims John, Matt, and Don, and I'm your tomeskeeper, Cody.
To Theater of the Mind Entertainment. I hope you all had sleepless nights and delusions of security. Last time, our predicament began with four unwary prisoners of fate, each learning of the Mauritania's mysterious reappearance in the New York harbor. Dr. Oliver McDowell and reporter Theodore Solomon meet to examine a set of photographs, one of which seems to capture the face of a little girl, which may suggest something sinister could be at work. Meanwhile, Private Investigator Benjamin Wesker and John Murdoch convene at the office of Police Chief Bernard McDonald. The Mauritania story has created quite a stir in the city, and Bernard is convinced he knows the culprit Leonard Prescott, a shady businessman who has been in McDonald's crosshair for years. This case should provide all the necessary evidence to finally put Prescott behind bars.
John and Ben, you're sitting across from Bernard, who is having a conversation with you about Leonard Prescott and how he wants you to investigate the Mauritania and find out if, in fact, Leonard Prescott was involved.
So, what do you guys say? Are you up for it?
Yeah, I'm up for it.
Yeah, I can do it.
But you realize Leonard Prescott is a pretty influential person, especially in the city. We may be opening up quite the hornet's nest. Are you ready for what's going to come down from this?
I realize that, but I'll be honest with you, John. I'm nearing retirement, and this just isn't right. He needs put behind bars.
Oh, I agree. I remember back in the 20s, with all the insurance scams that were going on, his name came across my desk more than once. Nothing was ever able to stick on him.
Yeah, nothing ever is. Let me give you guys everything I know. That night that the Mauritania was found, we got a call by a fisherman named Cliff Danhill. He called in and he seemed pretty shaken up. Apparently he had found the three suspects that are now in question. Unfortunately, I can't get to him yet. But he found them and they were covered in blood. No murder weapon was ever recovered. He's up at 314 River Lane in Greenwood Lake, New York. It's a bit of a drive, about an hour and a half. Maybe start there, see what he has to say. And if you do go and check out the Mauritania, I'll be sure to pull the detail tonight and make it a light one, so you can maybe slip in and get out without too much trouble.
That sounds good.
Yeah, I think that'll be doable.
All right, well, you guys get back to me with anything that you find.
Okay, we can do that.
He takes another drink of his scotch. And you see him turn around and he gets into a small drawer to get out a cigar.
Before you leave, you want a memento. I have these beautiful cigars here.
I'm not much for smoking cigars, but if it's free, I'll take it.
He hands it to you. He begins clipping it and lights it up.
You guys get going. Get back to me soon.
Will do.
Do you want to just ride together on this whole ordeal?
I suppose, Ben. I didn't catch your last name, though.
Wesker.
Wesker. You wouldn't be the same detective who found that missing Singleton kid, were you?
Yeah, that was me.
Feel a little more at ease riding up with you, then. That was quite the case you broke.
Yeah, it was a case, all right.
Huh. Thought you'd be taller.
I get that a lot.
My car's parked out back in the visitor parking area. I suppose we should head down that way?
Yeah, sounds good. Let's get going.
You guys walk out into the busy streets of New York, and you walk around back, and... John, what kind of car are you driving?
I drive a green Model A Roadster. Convertible.
You walk up to this Model A Roadster, and you hop in.
We're gonna head upstate New York to see Cliff.
It's gonna take you about an hour and a half to get there. You have a long road ahead of you. Meanwhile, back at the 5th Street Diner, Oliver and Theodore, you're still sitting at the booth discussing the Mauritania.
So, what do you say, Ted? You want to help me out?
You know, since you seem like a pretty decent guy, I don't have any reason to really disbelieve your story here. And this might make for some great radio coming up. Maybe I'll... why don't we go check it out together?
I really appreciate that. Thank you. What do you think we should do? I would like to take a look at the ship, maybe go out there and take some pictures of it and develop them and see how they turn out this time.
How are we even going to get out there? I mean, I imagine that thing is pretty swarming with police at this time right now, with it just coming back and all.
Well, I think if we go down there, I just want to snap a couple of pictures with the ship in frame.
I take a look at my watch. What time is it?
It's about 2 p.m.
Well, Oliver, I'll tell you what. I don't really got anything scheduled in for the rest of the day. Why don't we take a clip down there right now and check it out?
Sure. We can take some pictures. We can go back at the university. There is a dark room that I can get my pictures developed. Maybe after we look at the pictures, decide what to do from there.
It's worth a shot. I mean, I'll check it out. See if there's any validity to this story.
I've got a car.
I walked here, so works for me.
You guys get up and begin heading out of the diner. Hey, you guys take care.
Thanks a lot, Dave.
Hey, you're welcome, Theodore. And hey, nice to meet you, Oliver.
Yes, you too.
Take care. You walk out of the diner and you begin to approach a...
1936 green Buick Roadmaster convertible. And right now I have the top down.
Oliver walks around to the front and gets in. And Theodore, you walk and follow suit.
It's a real nice car you got here, man. Not too shabby for a fresh face like yourself.
Well, I'd be lying if I said that I bought it myself.
You guys jump in and begin heading towards the docks. You guys know that the Mauritania is being held at the docking bay 94. It takes you about 20 minutes to get there. You drive up, it's extremely crowded. And you see reporters lining the roads and lining the streets, trying to ask questions to any police officer they can get their hands on. And they're snapping pictures almost constantly. You barely find a place to park your car. It's actually about 4 or 5 blocks away. And you pull in.
Yeah, seems a lot of people read the newspaper this morning.
Yeah, probably didn't help that I broadcasted it either. Let's be honest here. I kind of look around.
You look around, and obviously New York City is extremely busy anyway. But the closer you get to the Mauritania, it's very indicative of a court case that is, you know, very popular. You see a ton of news reporters just trying to talk to officers to get the scoop. You see a lot of people taking pictures for what you're assuming to be the Sun or the Times or the newspaper. And it's just packed.
Do I happen to see any medical personnel, anything like that?
Go ahead and give me a spot, Hidden.
That's an 86 out of 55 fail.
Yeah, you don't really notice any medical personnel that would indicate that anybody's actually injured. But it's really crowded, so you can't be sure.
I'm going to try to look for a high place. Maybe a building or structure that's kind of looking out over the people, so maybe I can get a good shot of the ship.
Yeah, go ahead and give me a spot hidden.
Fail.
You look around to try to find maybe even a fire escape that you can climb up, and you happen to notice a fire escape down an alley, but the alley's extremely crowded, and you know that you would be noticed if you tried to climb up there.
Can you see anything from here? I don't know how good your camera is.
I pull out my camera, and I snap a couple of photos.
Yeah, go ahead and roll me a craft photography.
I got this. 18.
Yeah, you've definitely been in worse situations. This one's pretty bad, trying to get the shot that you want, but you are definitely able to get the shots that you're looking for. You're not really close, but you definitely know they're in frame, and whatever you're taking a picture of, it's what you want.
I think I got what we need.
All right, man. I mean, if you're good, let's go get those photos developed and be a little interested in maybe getting a little closer to this ship. Something doesn't seem quite right here. I mean, I don't see any EMTs. I don't see any doctors. I don't see anybody being carried off the ships.
Just cops and reporters.
I mean, my source told me that, you know, no one came back on the ship, and I'm pretty, you know my radio show. But let's just say, I didn't honestly believe it myself.
Well, I don't know if I want to start speculating just yet, Ted. But it does definitely seem weird. You know, they were covered in blood whenever they were found, and there are no bodies. That doesn't make any sense. So there's something out of place here.
Well, let's go, if you're ready, let's go get those developed.
You guys jump in the car and begin heading to the university. It's a good 20-minute car ride. Meanwhile, John and Ben, you've been driving now for a good 20 minutes, and you're about an hour away, and you've made it out of the city, and you're on these backcountry roads.
As I'm scanning along the radio, I'm just trying to make some small talk with Ben. Anything you want to listen to in particular on the radio? We still got a little bit of a ride ahead of us.
Nothing. Nothing, really.
It doesn't seem like I'm fussing, but it, like I said, it's really exciting to get to work with you. It was really before striking out on my own. I only really did insurance work. So opportunities to deal with an investigator of your caliber never really came before. So I'm going to say I'm pretty honored to be able to work with you right now.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd say honored. that's giving me some high praise. How long you been doing the investigating stuff?
Well, I've been out on my own now for about 7 years.
Oh, that's decent time. I mean, I came into it right from college, so I had a couple years where I just did some small work before I actually jumped into the business full-time, but I haven't been in it too much longer than you. I just kind of happened to luck out on that case, to be honest. I was in the right spot at the right time.
Really? I find that kind of surprising.
Well, being in the business, I'm sure you know how it goes. It looks like you know Bernie pretty well, or have worked with him at least before. So, I mean, sometimes it takes knowing the right person.
Yeah, but for Bernie, I usually only handle bookwork. A lot of the financial and record-keeping portion of the business. I still have a lot of contacts with a bunch of the insurance companies, so I'm able to gain access after hours and dig through files and get that sort of information for him.
I see. Speaking of Bernie, he seems like he's kind of taking this a little personal. Does he have some sort of thing for this Prescott?
Yeah, I'm not really sure what his connection is with Leonard Prescott, but he's definitely a person to not be messed with.
Yeah, people of his stature usually aren't.
About 15 years ago, when I was still working for Stafford Insurance, there were several cases that came through about fires in these textile facilities. A lot of the buildings were owned by Leonard Prescott. It all seemed like fraud, but there was really no way to put anything on him. You know, when you have the mayor's office and several other high-ranking people in the state, it's hard to get much moved around. So we cut the check and we're told to basically keep quiet.
I'm somehow not surprised. So, any particular game plan for when we get to this Danhill place?
I don't know. We'll have to see what it looks like when we get there. If he's just some old fisherman, no need to press him too hard.
You guys continue your drive, and it's about another 50 or 60 minutes up winding roads, and you pull off into 314 River Lane. It's back this dirt road, covered in trees, and you make your way back to this old, what appears to be an abandoned shack along the Hudson River. You notice down on the Hudson River, there's a small fishing boat. And this shack is really run down. The porch is dilapidated, appears to be rotting. And you don't see any lights on. It's about 4 o'clock. Pull up and you park your car. And you get out.
Ooh, I don't like the looks of this, Ben.
Yeah, it seems a little fishy.
You look around and you don't notice any other cars or anything of that nature.
Ben, you have your pistol on you, right?
Yeah. Yes, I do.
All right, well, I'm going to go up to the door and give it a knock and see if we can get this show moving here.
You walk up the creaking stairs onto the porch, and you knock on the door. You don't really hear anything.
Mr. Danhill.
There's no response.
Are there windows on the porch that I can step away from the door and try to peer in?
Yeah, there are two windows on the porch. You walk around. Go ahead and give me a spot.
I rolled under. My regular.
You look into the window, and the windows are extremely dirty and extremely dusty, and you kind of push your hand and smear some of the dirt around and try to clean it off as best as you can, and you peer into the window, and you look back almost into the kitchen, back a hallway, and you see a figure who appears to be sitting down in the hallway, just kind of rocking a little bit.
Hey, Ben. I think I see somebody in there.
I'm gonna go around the side and see if there's another way in or...
Yeah, Ben, you make your way around the side of the shack, and you don't really notice any other doors. It just appears to be a front door, and there's various windows around the side and around the back of the house, but it doesn't look like there's another doorway in.
Okay, I'm gonna come back around. This looks to be the only way into the house, so, you want to try to handle? When I say that, though, I'm going to, kind of put my hand on my pistol, just to be ready.
Mr. Danhill, are you here?
You hear footsteps kind of scuttering about inside.
Who's there?
Sir, my name's John Murdoch.
John Murdoch? Who's John Murdoch?
New York City Police Department sent me up here to get a statement from you, sir.
Am I in trouble?
No, sir. We just know there was a situation you were involved in, and they'd like to get a proper statement from you. I'm only here to get information from you, sir.
Okay, 1 minute, please.
You hear some scuttering around, and about a minute goes by, and you hear the door unlock. You see, standing in front of you, a very old man, probably late 70s, very wrinkly, very just worn out, very skinny, and he appears to be extremely disheveled. His eyes are kind of lingering. They don't really focus on you. He's looking past you. He's looking around you.
Do you want to come in?
If we may, sir.
Please, yes. Come in.
He turns around and he kind of hobbles with a limp inside and motions for you to follow. You walk in and you see, almost looks like there's pictures stapled to the walls of this symbol that you've never seen before. It's almost like an eye, like an eyeball with this serpent just kind of wrapped around it. And you look around and this symbol is everywhere in his house. And you also notice on the wooden walls, this symbol was carved many times into the wood.
Please, come in, have a seat.
And he walks into the kitchen dining area and pulls out a couple chairs and sits down.
Oh, so what can I do for you? Excuse me, I haven't been feeling well.
Mr. Danhill, we understand that you spotted a ship recently.
Yeah.
What exactly were you doing?
Yeah, I was just out fishing, just getting my catch for the day and just getting ready to
come back in. You notice as he's talking, he's just kind of scratching. Like, he's really uneasy and moving around and shifty.
You all right? You seem a little...
Yeah, no, I'm fine. I'm fine. I was just fishing. I haven't seen a storm like that in my entire life. It was just this brooding darkness, and just and I saw it. I saw the ship, and it was out. And then I saw the lifeboat. And yeah. Sorry. I'm sorry. You were saying.
The lifeboat. Did you get a really good look at the people that were on this boat?
They appear crazy. They were just there in the boat and bobbing about, you know, like boats do. And they were covered in blood. It was really weird. And it was strange.
As we came in your house, Mr. Danhill, I noticed all your artwork all over the walls.
Oh, do you like it?
I didn't realize you were quite the artist.
I've just picked it up about 13 hours ago. Do you like it?
Oh, it's very interesting. What's the symbolism behind it?
Yeah, it just came to me. It just came to me. I don't really know. Excuse me. Give me 1 minute. He gets up from the table and kind of hobbles behind the corner down the hallway. And he comes back out, standing in the middle of the kitchen, and he holds out this knife. There's just blood all over it, just dried and crusted blood. Yeah, you see, it called to me. The symbol. It's just called to me. Give me a spot hidden.
I failed.
I rolled under my hard.
Ben, you're just taken back by seeing this old man holding this bloody dagger, and you're just taken back. You don't even know what to say at this point. John, as he's talking about the symbol, you see on the hilt of this knife the same symbol etched and carved into the blade.
Mr. Danhill, where did you get such a fancy knife?
I found it. It's mine.
Found it where, sir?
Nowhere. Why do you want to know? Wait, why are you here?
People were murdered, Mr. Danhill. We're here to collect a statement from you about what you saw that night.
Murdered?
100 people. The Mauritania.
Wait a minute. The murdered? People weren't murdered?
I don't think they just walked off the boat, sir.
I don't know. I don't know.
Mr. Danhill.
Stop. Stop it. I can't. Just, they're, okay, yeah, they're coming.
Who's coming?
Oh, they're coming. They see you. They're coming for you. No, stop, why are you here?
Damn it, Mr. Danhill, no more games.
Stop yelling at me.
I stand up from the table.
I'm gonna ready my pistol.
Oh, stop! What? They're coming.
Who's coming?
They're coming! Oh, they're coming! They're already here. And you just see this man and these maniacal look in his eyes, and he takes the blade, and he shoves it into his wrist. And he just begins cutting his arm up to his elbow. They're coming for you. What did I do? Oh, God. And he puts the blade into his other hand and drives it into his wrist and cuts his arm up to his elbow. Oh, no. What have I done? Help me. Please, why are you standing there? Please. The blade just falls from his hand and hits the floor.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Please, help me.
Are there any towels? Is there anything like drapes or anything in the room?
He's spot hidden. In your panic, the only thing you can think to do is try to grab his wrist to stop the bleeding. You run over, and at this point, Cliff has fallen to the floor, and his blood is beginning to pool all around his body. You run over in a frantic state, and you grab a hold of his arms, and you're trying to stop the blood. And as you grab a hold of his arms, the warm, sticky sensation of this blood just begins to run between your fingers and down your arms.
Oh, no, let me die. He's coming for you.
Who?
And you just see the life
ready, let's go get those developed.
Drain from Cliff's. Roll sanity. John, you're able to hold it together and you watch this man die in your arms and you're covered in his blood. Ben, you're just stunned. Your gun was at ready and you just watch this old gentleman pass away. You're sitting there on the floor with Clifford kind of in your arms and the blood is just pulling around his body. And you've never seen so much blood in your entire life.
I can't believe he did that. I've never seen anybody just cut themselves open like that. Like a fish. Like a goddamn fish.
I don't see a phone anywhere. I don't know if we can even get a hold of somebody at this point.
I get up and I get to the sink and I try to clean myself up.
Yeah, you just begin scrubbing furiously to clean the blood off your hands. It washes off easy.
We need to get pictures of the scene. And we need to call Bernard.
Meanwhile, Oliver and Theodore, you pull up to the university, and Oliver, you know exactly where you're going. Theodore, you follow him in, and you make your way to the dark room.
I turn the dim lights on and begin the developing process.
So is this where you do all your magic?
This is where the magic happens. Whenever I have jobs, I come here. Since I did my doctorate here, I can come and use the facilities whenever I want.
You develop these photos, and you begin kind of looking over them. They turned out proper. You don't really notice anything strange. Yeah, both of you give me a spot hidden.
A 98, so fail. Hard.
82, which is a fail.
So you're looking over the photographs, and you don't notice anything out of the ordinary. They're pretty far away, but you just notice the police officers and the reporters, and you do see a few people on the ship, but nothing seems strange.
What the hell? These photos turned out completely normal. That doesn't make any sense. Why would these... How could that have happened? What is going on here? I take the old photos out of my jacket pocket. This doesn't make any sense. I used the same camera, the same kind of film. I was even basically the same distance for the up-close ones. I don't understand. This dark shadow, this little girl, why are they there?
Oliver, if you want to, you can actually spend the next, I would say, 4 to 5 hours poring through these photos and comparing them. And that would give you pretty much a hard success, if you'd like.
I could sit here and just analyze these photographs one by one. Maybe there's something that I'm missing.
I start thinking back through everyone that I know, just trying to find if maybe anyone I can think of can get me a little closer to the ship, possibly.
Give me a no roll.
I got a 6, a hard success.
Richard Kramer immediately comes to mind. He has been your source. He was actually your source for this whole story. And he has really pulled through for you in the past. You and Richard have a pretty long history.
I take a look at my watch. Well, Oliver, how about I'll tell you what. You stay here and keep looking at those photos. Who knows, maybe something will pop out at you. And I got someone I'm going to talk to. See if I can't get us a little edge in on this maybe later.
Well, that's a relief, at least. At least you've got some kind of lead. I suppose I will just stay here and just analyze these as closely as I can. Give me 4 hours.
Tell you what. Meet me back at the diner, say 8 or 9 o'clock, and should have all my ducks in a row, and we'll go check out that ship.
Okay, I will try to be there at 8:30.
Theodore, you begin heading down to the New York Sun's publishing, and when you walk in, you see a girl sitting behind the desk, and she looks up. Oh, hi, how can I help you?
Oh, hi, ma'am. I'm just here to see Richard, if he's in. Richard Kramer?
Yeah, give me one moment, please. She turns around and goes to a phone. Oh, yes, Richard, I believe there's somebody here to see you. Sir, what was your name?
Theodore.
His name is Theodore. Okay, yeah, I'll go ahead and send him up. She hangs up. Yeah, room 320, third floor.
I kind of tip my hat at her and I make my way past her.
You make your way to room 320 and the door's closed.
I walk up and just give a little gentle knock on the door.
Yes, come in.
Open the door, make my way in.
Hey, Theodore, how you doing today?
Hey, Richard, how's it going?
Well, just busy, but it's good.
Sorry to drop in on you unexpected here. I just had a favor I wanted to ask you.
A favor? I guess. What's on your mind? Have a seat.
I close the door on my way in and take a seat. So, Richard, you know that little bit of news that you dropped me about the Mauritania the other day?
Yeah, I do.
What if I wanted to, let's say, take a closer look at it, maybe?
What are you implying?
I'm implying that I don't have any more material for my show, and this is a really good story, and I'd love to maybe check it out a little closer, like 100 feet, 200 feet on the deck, who knows?
Well, what are you gonna do for me, Ted?
I mean, I can maybe rep the paper on my show. It's only a couple, we'll say a couple hundred listeners, but we could scratch each other's back here.
I think you're exaggerating. I think it's more like 50 listeners there, Ted.
All right, Richard. I mean, I don't need that kind of attitude from you on this.
Well, I mean, Ted, come on. You want me to break the law, pull strings, and you're going to get me maybe 50 listeners?
Whoa, buddy. I mean, Richard, I'm not saying break the law here. I'm just saying, what if a couple guards happened to fall asleep and I maybe took a look?
Okay. Tell you what, if you get in there to take a look, if you come right back to me with what you find, and I mean right back to me, so I'm the first reporter on this story of what is actually going on with the Mauritania, I think I can work something out for you.
I mean, I think we got a deal on that. We'll let you break the news first, and then it'll be on my show that evening.
He holds out his hand.
As I'm shaking his hand. So, what else you know about the Mauritania, Richard?
Well, what do you want to know?
I mean, there's a lot of questions there, but can I ask you what happened?
You know, I'm sure you've seen the piece that I wrote before the Mauritania left, and I had a chance to actually sit down with...
Leonard?
Yeah, Leonard. And there might have been some off-the-record conversation.
Oh, I bet there was.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not at liberty to discuss it.
What would make you at liberty? I mean, come on. Richard, we've known each other for a lot of years now. You know nobody really listens to my show, and even if they do, most people write it off as batshit. So, do you really think it's that much harm if maybe you just give me a little tidbit of info?
Go ahead and give me a persuasion.
89 out of 40, also a fail.
I don't know, Ted. I like my job a little too much. I tell you what, you come back with some information for me, and then maybe we'll talk.
I think I can make a deal on that.
Sounds good. So, how about this? Head in on the eastern docks, and I'll make sure it's a little light on duty.
I mean, I'm just going to go for a stroll later, so whatever I stumble upon is whatever I find, I guess.
We'll just leave it at that.
I stand up, extend my hand.
He extends his and shakes yours.
Thanks a lot, Richard. I appreciate it. You've always been there for me.
Hey, no problem, Ted. I do expect a story, though, when you get back.
Oh, you'll have a story.
I hope so.
and I make my way out of his office.
Theodore, you begin heading to the 5th Street Diner.
Meanwhile, John and Ben, you're at Cliff's place, and you've finished up snapping the photos, and you've taken about a good 40 minutes to kind of collect yourselves.
Ben, we have to get to a phone. I remember we passed that gas station on the way up here. I'm hoping they have a phone.
I'd imagine they would.
Let's get out of here. We'll talk to Bernard and then make arrangements to get this handled.
Ben and John, you head out of Cliff's and you jump in the car and begin driving down the highway.
Ben, what the fuck was that?
That was a guy killing himself.
I don't know how you can be so fucking cavalier about this. A guy just cut himself up right in front of us. All we need to do is get a fucking statement.
It takes about 10 minutes and you notice Easy Fill on your left-hand side and you pull into this really small-looking gas market. When you pull in, you notice there is a phone booth.
All right. Do you got a fucking dime?
Yeah, here's some change.
You get out of the car and you head up to the phone booth and you get in and you begin dialing Bernard's number.
Hello. This is Bernard.
Bernard.
John, yeah. Hey, how'd everything go with Cliff?
Cliff's dead.
What?
He killed himself right in front of us. We went in, sat down with him. Old guy, talking about what all went on. He goes in the back, pulls out a dagger, and starts cutting himself up right in front of us.
What?
It was like he was possessed. Like he was two different people.
Did he?
How the hell did you drop us into this mess?
John, I have no idea.
Look, we didn't touch anything. Do you have connections with anybody up here to go get this handled? I felt bad about leaving him that way, but the situation just went all pear-shaped.
Yeah, I mean, I'll get someone up there. Did anybody see you two?
Not that I know of. We left in such a hurry, I don't even know right now.
Okay, well, just kind of, just lay low, and yeah, I'll send somebody up there to take care of it. Maybe we can meet up tomorrow at some point. Just come down and we can maybe try to figure it out, but I'll get somebody up there.
Listen. He said somebody's coming. Somebody's coming for us. I don't know what's going on. Just watch yourself.
That's impossible. We'll talk about it tomorrow.
All right, thanks.
Hey, be safe.
You get off the phone and you jump back in the car and you begin heading down the highway towards the city.
Oliver, you make your way to the 5th Street Diner and you walk inside and you see Theodore sitting in the same booth that he's always in.
So, Oliver, anything jump out at you?
You're not going to believe what I found.
Well, I mean...
Remember that little girl that we saw in the captain's quarters?
She showed up again?
She showed up big time. I pull the photos out and lay them across the table. Did you see her on the ship when we were there? Because I don't remember seeing her on the ship when we were there.
I don't know, Oliver. I mean, to be honest, I didn't see anything. I mean, we were a good 300 to 400 yards away, but I'll give it to you, man. You got something here. I don't know what this is. I don't know what kind of magic or technology is going on here, but something's up. I'll tell you what. Got an appointment in about 45 minutes.
I definitely want to go back and check this ship out. There's either a little girl hiding on this ship, or we may have one of your conspiracies on our hands, Ted.
You guys get up and you walk out of the diner and get in the car and begin heading towards the ship. You make your way to the eastern dock and you park your car a few blocks away. You notice that the crowd definitely seemed to die down. There aren't too many people walking the streets, and there's definitely no reporters, and the police officers really seem to clear out.
Well, I take a look at the scene. It's a lot less crowded now.
As we pull towards the dock, I kind of point him towards the direction where I was told to go.
Ted, you give Oliver the directions that Richard Kramer had kind of told you to go. And Oliver, you pull the car into sort of an abandoned little empty parking lot. You guys begin heading towards the dock, and you notice a fenced-in area, kind of a gate, and there doesn't appear to be anybody there.
Guess the guard must have fallen asleep.
Seems rather convenient.
Well, you know, sometimes things work in mysterious ways.
You guys walk right through the gate and begin approaching the Mauritania. John and Ben, you pull up to the Mauritania, and you're kind of circling around the block to maybe get an idea as to where you might be able to park and kind of slip in unnoticed. Give me spot hidden.
Hard 19.
Regular 61.
Ben, as you're driving, John, you notice that there doesn't appear to be too many guards towards the eastern side of the ship.
Hey, Ben, look over there to the east. I think that'd be a good spot to try to get in.
All right, well, let's park this car and get going.
You park the car and you begin walking around the side, and it's pretty dark. And you notice a gate. Seems to be a little odd that at this gate there's no guards. And you walk in, unimpeded.
I wonder if this is where Bernie wanted us to go in at. He said he'd have the guards pretty light tonight.
You begin approaching the ship. Ben, as you're walking up to the Mauritania, you notice probably about 200 yards away, there are two figures that appear to be walking towards the ramp that lead up to the Mauritania dock.
We're supposed to be the only ones here, aren't we? I mean, minus some of the guards, but...
I don't know. Bernie didn't say anything about anybody else.
We better stay on our toes here. Approach this cautiously.
You guys continue walking towards the Mauritania. Oliver and Theodore, you make your way to the ramp that leads up to the deck of the ship.
As I'm standing at the foot of the ramp, I just take a general look around. I don't see or hear anybody.
You don't see a single soul.
I go ahead and start walking up the ramp.
You walk up the ramp and it's just creaking under your feet. And you make your way up to the deck. And the wind is just piercing your jacket. You look around and you don't see anybody.
As I reach the top, I turn to Oliver. Oliver, man, where about you think that girl was in those photos?
I take a look around. I think that's the captain's quarters. I'm pretty sure that's where the girl's face is in the first photograph.
Well, lead the way.
I nervously concede and start to lead the way, but before I do, I take a look around, make sure nobody's following us.
Yeah, you take a look around before you head up to the captain's quarters, and you don't really see anybody. You make your way over, and you notice there are stairs that lead up to the captain's quarters, and you walk up there.
I would like to pull my camera out and take a picture. Ted, do you want to go in?
As we walked, as he was taking pictures, I was kind of just keeping my eye open for any blood, any signs of any what might have went on here.
Go ahead and give me a spot hidden.
Rolled a 49 out of 55.
So you're looking around for any indication of struggle or violence, and everything seems and appears to be absolutely pristine. But just as Oliver snaps a photo, you think you hear something down below off the ship. And as you turn around, you see two men approaching the ship.
Oliver, stop taking photos.
What? Why?
Just stop. I think the guards might be coming up here.
Oh, shit.
John and Ben, you're at the ramp of the ship, getting ready to board. As you turn the corner to get onto the ship, you hear this snapping sound, like a photo is being taken. And you look up, and you see two men standing right at the captain's quarters.
What do you think, they're reporters? I can't see them being guards if they're up there sneaking around taking pictures. I mean, you saw those two guys, right?
Yeah, definitely saw them. Definitely shouldn't be guards. at that time, I'm unholstering my gun. I'm pulling it out.
Are you sure that's a good idea?
Ben, you ready your weapon, and you and John begin walking up onto the deck of the Mauritania, and you begin walking up to the captain's quarters. Theodore and Oliver, you see two men, one who readies his weapon, walk up onto the deck of the ship. At this point, they're probably about 20 yards away.
Oliver, buddy, let's go this way. And I kind of point and start grabbing him as I, like, usher him away from the apparently armed men down the deck, basically, almost to, like, loop around the ship.
Ben and John, you see one gentleman kind of pushing along another one as they scurry away.
I'm going to motion to John to, like, go around and try and cut them off.
Oh, shit. Okay.
John, you make your way around to cut these two individuals off. Ben, you run up to the captain's quarters deck, and you see them kind of beginning to run away. Oliver and Theodore, as you're moving along rather quickly, you run right into John.
Easy, guys, easy. What are you doing here?
Just here with the police department, taking some
investigative photographs.
Theodore, give me a persuade.
54 out of 40.
And Oliver, give me a persuade.
I rolled a 25, hard success.
Theodore, you're kind of fumbling over your words here. You're definitely taken back by John's presence.
Yes, we are here taking some investigative photographs for the police. What are you doing here, sir?
Much the same as you.
You don't look like you're taking photographs.
I pull out my collapsible camera. I say, well, you startled us. I really didn't know what to think. Bad things happened on this ship.
Yes, they did.
Tend not to take chances.
Neither do we, sir.
I take a step closer to you, and I sort of squint my eye. You can see me squinting, like I can sort of trying to place where I've seen you before. Oliver?
Yes, that is my name. You know me?
Oliver.
Yeah.
NYU, right? You worked in the photography department.
Yes, I did. I still do dabble there.
Holy smokes. John Murdoch, I used to work for Stafford Insurance. You would develop film for us down there from accidents and claims.
Oh, yeah. You're right, I did.
It's been a long time. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Not bad. I mean, I don't work for Stafford anymore. I'm out on my own. But you must be doing well working for the police department like this. Good on you, bud.
Yeah, I'm doing great for myself because I absolutely work for the police department.
By this time, Ben, you make it back to John and you see him conversing with these two men.
Well, ain't that just nice? Two hens find the hen house.
Yeah, small world. It's good to see old acquaintances sometimes.
I don't know about the company you keep, but I mean, you know what you're doing.
Well, this man knows what he's doing. He's just having a rough night.
Tell me, you've never heard of Ted Solomon, Dark Wave Radio?
Can't say that I have, but next time I'm digging on the radio, I'll make sure to try to find you, Bill. Or what was your name?
Ted. Ted Solomon.
I will write that down.
I hear him saying that. Why am I not surprised? Ted.
Well, look at that. We got somebody who listens. Someone who's in on the truth.
I'm sorry, I meant no offense by that, but just I don't
listen to the radio?
Well, we shouldn't say that, but I just haven't found you on the airwaves.
Well, I mean, whatever kind of propaganda machine you want to listen to. I'll tell you what, buddy.
All right. Don't get your dander up, son.
Who's this friend of yours again? The smart one.
My name's Ben. Ben Wesker.
Surely you've heard of him.
Is he also a radio host?
Never mind that. What exactly are you doing here? And who's this gentleman over here?
Well, I'm Dr. Oliver McDowell. It's nice to meet you, Benjamin Wesker. I am a photographer for the New York Police Department.
Well, it seems like we're all here for the same reason.
At about that time, everybody give me a listen check.
I got a 86 out of 20.
I got a 52 under 55.
I got a 55.
I rolled a 4 for a hard or extreme success.
Oliver, you hear a loud thud coming from a room down below on the first deck.
Did anybody else just hear that?
My only wave's here, buddy.
I just heard something. It sounded like it was coming a couple levels below us. Some loud thumping thud noise.
Well, there's only the two of us, so unless you brought more people...
Just the two of us.
Think we should take a look?
I'd rather not.
Maybe it's the little girl.
Little girl?
Well, I'm going to be honest with you, John. This isn't the first time I've taken photographs of this ship. At this point, I pull the photographs out and I show them to John.
Oh, okay. I mean, what does all this mean then?
All I know is this little girl has appeared in several photographs I've taken of this ship. And she's not... this is going to sound crazy. She's not there in real life. Yeah, you know, with the naked eye, she's not there, but whenever I take the photographs, she appears. And just something about this ship. In some of the photographs, there's a dark shadow over the deck. That's the main reason we're here. There's something not right. And I know I just heard something down below. I think we should go take a look.
I'm so glad I'm not the one that sounds like the crazy person now. Well, I don't want to be the one to go down there and check it out. I mean...
Maybe the guy with the gun should go first.
Buddy, I don't take any orders from you.
Easy, Ben. He didn't mean nothing by it.
Well, wasn't an order. It was a suggestion, sir. I apologize.
Well, John, we're here to look at the ship. Do you want to go check this out?
I pull out my camera, and I'm like, well, this is what we came here for. The events of today have been crazy as it is. Let's just be ready.
Lead the way, my friends.
You guys begin walking down the stairs to the first deck. And you make your way to where Oliver believes the sound was coming from. And you walk into this really ornate-looking sitting room. It's a really nice bar, really nice paintings, extremely ornate woodwork. And you make your way back, pretty dark hallway. And as you're walking back this hallway, you hear some scuffling coming from down below, down these stairs. And you make your way around the corner, and you look down the spiraling staircase, and you see lying at the bottom of the stairs, a guard lying in a pool of his own blood, and his throat slit. And that's where we're going to call it.
That concludes our show for this evening. Thank you so much for listening to Theater of the Mind Entertainment. Please, have safe travels and don't worry about peering behind your shoulder. They're already here. Ta-ta.